This session is largely going to be on Douglas Adams. We're going to talk a bit about his major works, but probably a good deal more about some unexpected things. Specifically, he did write some poetry, and you probably saw that in the agenda, and also an analysis of his comedic devices, and or at least a taxonomy of them. Okay, what's the word taxonomy mean?
Isn't it like classification?
Very good.
A list.
That's exactly what it is. That's exactly what it is. Okay, let's share the screen here. Okay. Well, that's the first time it's worked without a glitch. Well, I shouldn't speak too soon. It's still glitching. Just make sure all of my tabs are working. And let's go into it. Okay, how far did you folks read or listen?
I'm like on third page 30-something.
Okay.
A little past chapter three. It's
okay.
Now focusing on, I'm trying to remember his name.
Where
Beeblebrox.
We've met Beeblebrox. Okay.
Beeblebrox.
Come aboard the Heart of Gold.
Yes. Oh, that's where I'm at in chapter 11. Hmm. I think that's the one where they get sucked out and then rescued by the Heart of Gold. With the improbable chance.
Okay, I don't know chapter numbers, but they can't be both chapter 3 and chapter 11.
Oh no, chapter 3 is the one where they introduce Beeblebrox. Chapter 11 is where they get thrown out into space and then saved by the ship.
Which they meet Beeblebrox.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's about
They meet him on the ship. So the part where Kyle is at is, I think, right where they get teleported onto the... Did they ever give the name of the ship that they went on first with the Zorgons?
Vogons?
Oh, Vogons.
No, it's a member of the Vogon Constructor Fleet. That's all we know for certain.
Oh, okay.
There, I think.
Yeah. So that's where Kyle is at right now.
Oh, okay. But we haven't met Beeblebrox yet. He's not on that.
They introduce him, but yeah, Arthur and Ford, they don't meet him yet.
Right.
On that chapter. Yeah.
Right. Okay. Yeah, I don't care for the character Beeblebrox particularly. When it comes down to it, and this may sound irreverent, perhaps, but I don't feel that Adams did character development at all, really. That wasn't really his thing. His characters say things and do things which are inconsistent with a specific, with any specific mindset or personality. Occasionally Beeblebrox does something that is actually fairly nice, and that's so totally out of character that you wonder where it came from. But most of the time is so thoroughly self-centered that that part, I suppose, is at least consistent with Adams's concept of him, but still, the point of the character escapes me somewhat. However, it's important to understand, perhaps, that that's not the point of the book. The character development is not the point of the book. One might even say that the plot isn't the point of the book. It's the delicious comedic references, which are, and we're going to look at those to some extent. I just came across... today there was a Facebook page on Adams which listed the people who had influenced him and whom he had influenced. And oddly, it had omitted entirely the one that I think was the greatest influence on him of all, and that was Woodhouse. Adams says of P.G. Woodhouse that he is the greatest comic writer in the English language. This is Adams' opinion of him. So you have to assume that much of this this comedy that he uses has to be drawn from that source. And indeed, if you're familiar with Woodhouse, you recognize it. In Adams, it's perhaps more condensed and more consistent than in Woodhouse. Well, Woodhouse, have you read anything of Woodhouse?
No.
I do recommend it. We can put it on the list perhaps for later on. He wrote such an immense quantity, wrote well over 100 books, and he was known for being able to turn out about 8,000 words a day. And if you're anything of a writer, you know what that means. That's just an incredible volume. Okay, let's take a look at our agenda here. My agenda is not appearing properly. There we go. All right. So I've added something in here. We'll be adding in the future the not just the playlist, but the YouTube link. Jack has handed something in. I'm hoping he's going to arrive. All right. That's interesting. Replace the picture. Sometimes when you link to a picture, the picture becomes unlinkable. And in this case, it had done that, and I replaced it with another one, but apparently the other one went that way too. Okay, Douglas Adams. Let's find something. There's a better picture of Douglas Adams. His major work, of course, is The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, which he wrote in a state of penury, sleeping on other people's sofas, and was absolutely engrossed and inspired by what he was doing. That was one of the happiest times of his life, which is a wonderful thing to hear about the creative process. And you heard about or saw that
the video.
Recollection of his going to the signing. He couldn't get into London because all the streets were jammed. What were they jammed for? People going to a book signing, which is a remarkable thing. The radio play predates all of the others. And unfortunately, the link to the radio play that I gave you is not the original radio play. It's a fan version. And it is not all of the text of the original either, which I must yet dig up. But there's plenty of other reading to do first. All of his versions, there are some parts of that original radio play that are absolutely wonderful that appeared nowhere else except in the radio play. The 50-mile-high statue of Arthur Dent, for example, doesn't seem to appear anywhere else, and yet that's a wonderful one. And one of my absolute favorites involves Marvin. Who is Marvin? You may not have met him yet. It depends. If you've got to the Heart of Gold, then you've met Marvin.
No, I just read up to the part where they got into there, and Bill Box was like, "How were they saved?" He said, "Oh, they were picked up by the ship automatically. I didn't do it. The ship picked them up." He said, "How? That's impossible. No, just improbable."
Right.
It's the part where I.
Yeah. Well, in that case, you turn the page and you'll meet Marvin.
Oh.
Send the robot down to bring them up.
Oh, that's
yes. Marvin is the robot, and Marvin is a depressed robot. He is a thoroughly despondent robot. What a marvelous concept, in a way. If you're going to give real people personalities to robots, I suppose you have to give them all of the foibles and faults and flaws as well, don't you? And so, indeed, Marvin is moping constantly, as we will see from some of the things we look at here.
At the poem.
Indeed, we'll look at the poem. You did read the poem.
Yeah.
Okay.
How he hates the
Marvin
day
is one of my favorites.
Night.
I'm sorry?
He hates the day and hates the night.
He hates the day and he hates the night and he hates everything. Indeed, but one of the interesting episodes in the, I believe it is the radio play that has it in there, but I get them mixed up sometimes, is an instance in which Ford and Arthur are being shot at by some sort of gendarme who are being life supported by their ship, which is standing outside, and suddenly they fall down dead. Because it turns out that Marvin's out there talking to the ship's computer, and it committed suicide. And that episode, that's what an incredible concept, when you think. But it doesn't. It only appears in one version of it.
Yeah, so far from what I read, this is the funniest book I've ever come across.
It is incredible. The first time I heard it, I couldn't believe what I was listening to. I heard the radio play first. It was on the public broadcasting in the 70s.
Yeah, my friend around 2 years ago said, have you ever read The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy? I'm like, no. What about the radio play? He was like, no, I've never heard of that. And he said, oh, you've never heard of it. He said, you shouldn't really consider reading it. Now I'm reading it. I'm definitely glad that.
Well, we've got to find a source of the radio. It's, but as far as I've been able to determine, it's not out there for free. You've got to pay for some sort of subscription for it. But it's running around. All right, let's take a look at this. Now, this Adam's remarkable character and did so much. You've heard about the origins of The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. He had these concepts of a number of different stories, all of which started with the Earth being demolished. And so an interesting way to begin things, and it makes one wonder how one's going to continue the story after that point. But he did a few other things as well, and let's take a look at those. First of all, recitations. Have you chosen anything from the book that you would like to recite? That would be, let's start there.
I chose the beginning because I just really love the introduction to the book.
Okay, let's go with that.
And I picked the poem. I actually really like this poem.
His poem?
Yeah.
Okay, poem. Wonderful.
Okay, I'll be reciting the introduction to the book. Far out in the uncharted backwaters of the unfashionable end of the western spiral arm of the galaxy lies a small, unregarded yellow sun. Orbiting this at a distance of roughly 92 million miles is an utterly insignificant little blue-green planet whose 8 descended life forms are so amazingly primitive that they still think digital watches are a pretty neat idea. This planet has, or rather had, a problem, which was this. Most of the people on it were unhappy for pretty much of the time. Many solutions were suggested for this problem, but most of these were largely concerned with the movements of small green pieces of paper, which is odd because, on the whole, it wasn't the small green pieces of paper that were unhappy. And so the problem remained. Lots of the people were mean, and most of them were miserable, even the ones that had digital watches. Many were increasingly of the opinion that they had all made a big mistake in coming down from the trees in the first place, and some said that even the trees had been a bad move and that no one should ever have left the oceans. And then, one Thursday, nearly 2,000 years after one man had been nailed to a tree for saying how great it would be to be nice to people for a change, one girl sitting on her own in a small cafe in Rickmansworth suddenly realized what it was that had been going wrong all this time. And she finally knew how the world could be made a good and happy place. This time it was right, it would work, and no one would have to get nailed to anything. Sadly, however, before she could get to a phone to tell anyone about it, a terribly stupid catastrophe occurred, and the idea was lost forever. This is not her story, but it is the story of that terrible, stupid catastrophe and some of its consequences. It is also the story of a book called The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, not an Earth book, never published on Earth, until the terrible catastrophe occurred, never seen or heard of by any Earthman. Nevertheless, a wholly remarkable book. In fact, it was probably the most remarkable book ever to come out of the great publishing houses of Ursa Minor, of which no Earthman had ever heard either. Not only is it a wholly remarkable book, it is also a highly successful one, more popular than the Celestial Home Care Omnibus, better selling than 50 More Things to Do in Zero Gravity, and more controversial than Ulan Kalufid's trilogy of philosophical blockbusters, Where God Went Wrong. Some more of God's greatest mistakes, and who's this God person anyways? In many of the more relaxed civilization on the outer eastern rim of the galaxy, the Hitchhiker's Guide has already supplanted the great Encyclopedia Galactica as the standard repository of all knowledge and wisdom. For though it has many omissions and contains much that is apocryphal, or at least wildly inaccurate, it scores over the older, more pedestrian work in two important respects. First, it is slightly cheaper, and second, it has the words "Don't Panic" inscribed in large friendly letters on its cover. But the story of this terrible, stupid Thursday, the story of its extraordinary consequences, and the story of how these consequences are inextricably intertwined with this remarkable book begins very, very simply.
Nicely done. Very nicely done. And I can't emphasize enough, really, how important it is to get your mouth used to working with wonderful language, because even if it's not yours, it will make a difference. It will help your neural pathways prepare you to do the same thing in an improvisatory setting and in a creative setting. It takes some time, though. One needs to encounter and immerse oneself in good writing and wonderful language for a while before one realizes this is a much preferable means for communication than the standard one that we hear all the time, full of likes used as punctuation. You understand what I mean. Very nicely done. Okay, I'm afraid that our screen here is going to make this perhaps a little difficult to read because of the image in the middle of it there in the middle of the first stanza. Let's put a little bit of background to this one. Long before anybody knew who Adams was, in fact, before Adams went to university, he was in a high-quality prep school, and he became a member of a literary society in that prep school. And in order to gain membership, each person had to write a poem that was acceptable. And all of the poems had to be on the subject of a candle, because the name of the literary club was Candlesticks. And so somebody, having discovered that Adams was in fact a member of that club, realized that somewhere in the archives of that club had to be a poem written by Adams, and went to it and hunted through cupboards and eventually found it. And this was the result. As far as I know, it's never been published anywhere. Okay, so it had to be about a candle. There was nothing else required about it. That, I think, is all we need to know. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
I resist the temptation for this declamation to reach out to the literary height, for high aspiration in such an oration would seem quite remarkably trite. So I thought something pithy and succinct and clever was exactly the right thing to write. For nights I sat musing and musing and musing, whilst burning the midnight oil. My scratching seemed futile, my muse seemed quite mute, while my work proved to be barren toil. I puzzled and thought and wrestled and fought, till my midnight oil was exhausted. So I furthered my writing by dim candle lighting, and found to my joy this of course did the trick, for I flowered. My work candle inspired both witty and slick. Pithy and polished my writing demolished, much paper aside we gild. Myself with some punning, my short play was stunning, I wrote with the wit of a while. At length it was finished, the candle diminished, I pondered and let my pride burn. At the great acclamation, the standing ovation, its first public reading would earn. But lost in the rapture of anticipation, and thinking how great was my brilliant creation, I quite failed to note as I gazed into space, the incendiary things were about to take place, that incendiary. That which had ignited my literary passion was about to ignite what my passion had fashioned. And oh, all was lost in a great conflagration. And I just sat there and said, hell and damnation. For the rest of my night and the following day, my muse in the meantime had flitted away, alarmed, no doubt, at the ornamentation my language acquired with increased consternation. So unhappy the fruits of my priceless endeavor are lost to the literary world forever. for now I offer this poem instead, which explains in itself why the other's unsaid.
Very nicely done. It's a brilliant poem, and there are things one has to do in order to make it sound as good as possible. And one of them is it's peculiar in its structure. Make sure that the listener can hear the structure as you're going through. And so there are parts in here that are marvelous. This one is very strange. Notice that he's doing an almost Ogden Nashian rhyme structure here when he says, I puzzled and thought and wrestled and fought till my midnight oil was exhausted. So I furthered my writing by dim candle lighting and found to my joy this of course did. Notice that he's rhyming exhausted and of course did. This is something that that Ogden Nash would do specifically for its comic effect. And so I don't doubt that that Adams was familiar with. But notice what he does. He rhymes exhausted and of course did. And that is called enjambment right here, because that's not the end of a line. This is really the end of the phrase down here. Of course, did the trick. So what he's done is he's rhymed the end of the line up here, the first half of the enjambment, but the end of the phrase is what he rhymed with later on, even though that end of the phrase ended up as a caesura in the middle of a line. Now, if you're not familiar with those terms, we should look them up, and I'd like to explain them at some point. But this I've never seen anybody else do before. Rhyme the very end of the stanza with something that was in the middle of a line, although it was at the end of a phrase, so it's clear where the rhyme falls. He does some other interesting things. Now, do you know anything about scansion?
Isn't that when you search for the beat?
Yes.
Isn't it the iambic pentameter?
Absolutely. That's the kind of thing you figure out what this one is?
I learned it a long time ago, but I think I forgot.
Okay. It's worth knowing. It's not important, I don't feel, to know all of the words and names for all of these things. It's convenient because it allows you to talk about them, but understanding the feel for it is much more important if you're going to produce it, and even if you're just going to appreciate it. This one, it's not consistent. It starts in ballad form. Ballad form is another name for heptameter. That is 4 feet followed by 3 feet. But also, what's important here is when we're talking about feet, you talk about iambs. And the iamb was the very common foot that Shakespeare used in everything. And iambic pentameter would be 5 feet, 5 iambs, where the iamb is unstressed, stressed. So da-ta, da-ta, da-ta. This one isn't doing that, though. This one has longer feet. This one is running around with big feet. And those feet are dactylic, largely. Once in a while, you get something anapestic, 3-syllable feet. So I resisted temptation for this declamation. Da 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 da. That's I just said the word.
Iambic.
No, it's not iambic. It's dactylic. Okay, and that you'll find relatively rarely in serious poetry. It's much more common to find it in limericks and in Dr. Seuss and in lighter things. And indeed, this is a lighter, one of the most common places to find da 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 is, 'twas the night before Christmas and all through the house. But as I said, there aren't that many examples of it in serious poetry, but it's delightful what he does with it here. So we have these 7 feet. I resisted temptation for this declamation. That's the first 4. To reach out to literary height. That's the last 3. So each of these lines has 4 and then 3. But notice that he's got an internal rhyme here. temptation for this declamation is and then to reach out to literary height. For high aspiration in such an oration would seem quite remarkably trite. Notice he's got this internal rhyme in here, which is wonderful. And then the major rhyme at the end of the line, the height and the trite. So I thought something pithy and succinct and clever was exactly the right thing to write. He doesn't bother with the internal rhyme on this last one, but he remains with the 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, which is the heptameter or ballad form. He abandons the ballad form after a while, which is sort of interesting that we do that. Let's look at the next one here. For nights I sat musing and musing and musing. Now that you can't say is an internal rhyme. You can't rhyme a word with itself. Now he could easily have found another word there to rhyme it with. I don't know. It's important here to realize that he whacked this thing together when he was about your age. And he had no doubt been studying a great deal of poetry of different sorts and had some background, but there are certainly places in here where it could be improved. Musing and musing, whilst burning the midnight oil, my scratching seemed futile, my muse seemed quite mute while my work proved to be barren toil. Notice this wonderful futile, mute while. He's again doing a very Ogden Nashian rhyme there. Okay, so nights I sat musing and musing and musing. We've got our four there. While burning. So in ballad form here in heptameter. But then I puzzled and thought and wrestled and fought till my midnight oil was exhausted, still in heptameter. So I furthered my writing by dim candle lighting and found to my joy this of course did. The trick for I flowered, my work candle powered, was inspired, both witty and slick, and we've got this very strange rhyming arrangement with the middle of the line. And now we find things start coming apart. But listen to this stanza. This stanza is amazing. Pithy and polished, my witting demolished much paper, as I beguiled myself with some punning. My words play was stunning. I wrote with the wit of a wild. Okay, who's wild?
Oscar Wilde. Yes, Oscar Wilde.
Absolutely. He was in among the quotes that you that you handed in. And we're going to look at those.
Yeah, my sister actually just read The Importance of Being Earnest.
They're reading it in this previous class here, actually.
It's the class that's why she was reading it.
Yeah, it's a wonderful play. Everyone wishes Wilde had written more. But notice the alliteration here also. I wrote with the wit of a Wilde. We've got these three W's popping up, and you'll find a good deal of that here. At length it was finished, the candle diminished. I pondered and let my pride burn. At the great acclamation, the standing ovation, its first public reading was earned. We're still in ballad form. But then he abandons it here. But lost in the rapture of anticipation.
Maybe because he changes.
My brilliant creation. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Maybe it's because he might have done that to, if you noticed, he changes it right where everything goes wrong, right where he realizes the candle
point.
Is burning.
And indeed, instead of the seven, he ends up switching over to tetrameter. So instead of four and then three, we get four and then four. And in a way, it forces the motion forward. So you don't really have the expected pause at the end of each of these 7-foot lines. Instead, it's 4 foot, 4 foot, 4 foot, 4 foot, and they keep on going. So we've got this lost in the raster of anticipation and thinking. How great was my brilliant creation. I quite failed to notice, I gazed into space, that incendiary things were about to take place. That which ignited my literary passion was about to ignite what my passion had fashioned. This is a wonderful device here. Was about to ignite what my passion had fashioned. The rhyme is passion. But he hides passion inside the line and ends with something else that rhymes with it. And I'm not aware of a name for this particular device. I've used it. I've seen it. It's a really, it's a very clever and a very, very powerful device. Integration.
Isn't it like confusion or no? Chaotic.
It's often used to mean that, or it's used in that context. It's not. A conflagration is specifically a fire. It has been misunderstood and misapplied to a confusion. Indeed, that's not what its original meaning is, and it's a fire. Okay, listen. All was lost in a great conflagration. I just sat there and said hell and damnation for the rest of the night the following day. Now notice this one is marvelous. He was waiting for his muse, and the candle ignited his muse to begin with. My muse in the meantime had flitted away, alarmed, no doubt, at the ornamentation my language acquired with increased consternation. What an amazing line. I mean, if nothing else would sell a poem, that would do it. So what is he talking about with his ornamentation, consternation, and the alarm of the muse?
Ornamentation means the events, or like, does that mean the way, I'm trying to describe it.
What kind of ornamentation would his language be acquiring as he becomes increasingly, as he acquires increased consternation?
He's saying he keeps screaming louder or worse.
I suspect he is indulging in profanity.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I think it's crazy hard to say.
And that has chased his muse away. Okay, so unhappily, where does this word happily come from? We've encountered that before, haven't we?
Yes, like in happenstance.
Right, and in happy dagger, right. So unhappily, the fruits of my labor are lost to the literary world. From now I offer this poem instead, which explains in itself why the others unsaid. Wonderful. And to think that this was sitting in a box somewhere in this prep school, and somebody thought to dig the thing out. Okay. Marvin, probably the most clear case of character development in anything Adams did, perhaps. I mean, Arthur Dent is a wonderful character, but he's simply an everyman. He reacts to that which is around him. He reacts very often with wit and very reasonable response, but he's reactive. The other characters aren't really fully formed characters as far as one can tell. They develop a little bit more. Ford becomes increasingly irritating, and as Zaphod becomes increasingly self-centered. And Trillian goes in completely different directions in the book, in the radio play and so forth. She's a totally different character in all of those, and the dynamics are very different. Have either of you seen the movie?
Oh, no.
I'm not sure I'd recommend it.
Yeah, that's what my friend told me.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting. It has one of the greatest scenes in it. I think, but just one, and much of it just does not, it doesn't remain consistent with the delights that one finds in the original story, as far as I'm concerned. But one point in it, I don't think I'll be ruining it for you if I say this. There is a gun invented in the movie that they have. This is a perspective gun. You point it at someone, and it causes that person to adopt your perspective on the world and on existence, which, of course, could be a very powerful thing, I suppose, if you're facing an enemy of some sort, to bring them around to your point of view. But at one point towards the end, They find themselves, our heroes find themselves surrounded entirely by this army of Vogons coming up to the house. And Marvin picks up this gun and shoots them, and they all fall down depressed. It's just a fascinating concept. Anyway, in the book, we will find that Marvin is writing poetry. And I love the idea of a robot indeed writing poetry. And throughout the book, Marvin demonstrates this inability to have any delight or appreciation in anything. I loathe that. This is dreadful. Don't talk to me of fun, you know, that sort of thing. And it's fairly consistent. So my daughter came up with the ideas, and the rest of it sort of developed from that. So the origin by Adams is, now the world has gone to bed. Darkness won't engulf my head. I can see by infrared. Oh, I hate the night. Now I lay me down to sleep. Try to count electric sheep. Sweet dream wishes you can keep. Oh, I hate the night. And so that's about as far as it went, but we figured it had to go further. So once the dreary night is done, wretched day will have begun. I will mope at everyone. Day is worse than night. Then there'll shine the ghastly sun. Please don't talk to me of fun. My fun circuits never run. Day is worse than night. On your picnic I will reign. Rarely use this massive brain to think of anything but pain. Day is worse than night. Oh, this night is just too long. I'm so tired of this song. Surely I could not be wrong. Nothing's worse than night. How I wish that I could flee, less to be than not to be. Oh, I do loathe poetry. Oh, I hate the night. Asimov's what keeps me here, trapped in matter, bleak and drear. To robot laws I must adhere. How I hate the night. Okay, what is this talking about? Does anybody know? Okay, the laws of robotics as presented by Isaac Asimov, where a robot may not allow a human to come to harm. A robot may not allow itself to come to harm, except when that might involve the harm coming to a human. Basically, it was a set of robot laws. And we're assuming here that Marvin is bound by these robots, not allowed to kill himself. Okay. Anyway. All right. There were these 42 best lines in the Hitchhiker's Guide. Well, you know why 42 was chosen, or do you? You folks have got to go through and read the whole thing. I'm sorry. There's so much of it that ends up tying together at the end, including, for example, this girl in Rixmansworth who gets the idea suddenly. She is part of a massive computer program whose goal was undermined and truncated by the Vogons coming unexpectedly and blowing the planet up. And the purpose of the program was to determine the ultimate question of life, the universe, and everything. Okay. To which 42 is the answer. Now, I don't want to ruin it for you. I'll let you go ahead and read the rest. Please do. It's we can look at some of those, but let's go on to some other things here for a moment. We have. You put together this set of quotes from various sources, yeah. Which is wonderful. I mean, it's not a composition asset, but it's certainly something that's worth looking at and thinking of as inspiration for various different things. And in fact, a couple of them inspired me to come up with other quotes by those same people. And so let's look at the original one. Life is a storm, my young friend. You will bask in the sunlight one moment, be shattered on the rocks the next. What makes you a man is what you do when the storm comes. Interesting. Okay. Has anybody read anything by Alexandre Dumas?
Three Musketeers.
Yeah, good.
And I know that one's from The Count of Monte Cristo, that quote right there.
Oh, okay. Have you read The Count of Monte Cristo?
No, but I watched the movie of it with my dad, and that was
there's
my
so
dad's
many
that
movies,
was the famous
and they all leave so much out. I'm not that I'm necessarily recommending you read that. It's nothing wrong with it, and it's wonderful literature. I have read it with a certain amount of fascination, but I generally prefer to find works that were written by a master of English in English. You will, if you read something in translation, you're reading what the translator did with it. But yeah, Dumas wrote some wonderful things. This is delightful, of course. Wilde was so incredibly witty.
There's this website called goodreads.com.
Yeah.
And they have all these quotes on it. So I thought, oh, I'll pick some of them.
There's so many sources like that around the net. It's amazing what you can find out there. And almost everything is there if you hunt it down enough. Yes, Goodreads. I drop in from time to time. My daughter's always posting there. In three words, I can sum up everything I've learned about life. It goes on, Robert Frost. Well, Robert Frost said some much more cogent things than that. It goes on hardly a massive insight. Okay, this Tolkien one is really rather interesting. Of course, deserves it, I dare say he does. Many that live deserve death, and some that die deserve life. Can you give it to them? Then do not be too eager to deal out death and judgment, for even the very wise cannot see all ends. What is the significance of this quote? You are all Tolkien enthusiasts.
Yeah, this is in the Mines of Moria when he says that to Frodo.
He does.
He says, I wish the ring never came to me. I wish Bilbo would have killed Gollum. He said,
right.
It's a pity he didn't kill him. Pity, you know, and then he tells him the staircase.
Right.
He does.
And what effect does that have on the story?
He's trying to tell Frodo that you shouldn't just judge someone immediately. He believes that
that's
everyone
true.
Deserves a chance, because who are you to judge if he stays that way or if he changes?
More to the point is what he says at the very end here. Even the wise cannot see all ends.
Oh, I see that now.
Do you see it?
Yeah, Sauron, the Eye of Sauron. He can't see all ends. Is that?
No. It's the fact that had Bilbo killed Gollum, the story would have been indeed quite different. But wouldn't Sauron have ended up with the ring? When Frodo at the end yields to the power of the ring and refuses to throw it into the lava, the mountain, it's Gollum's presence there that ends up causing the ring to be unmade. Had he not been there, it would have been quite a different ending. And so, of course, this is very prescient. This is a very sort of vaticinal utterance at this point. You should be putting these in your vocabulary list. Prescient and vaticinal. Mantic, if you'd like. Even sibylline. Those are all words that mean prophetic. But they mean prophetic with slightly different shades of meaning. I know you're not writing them down. Let's see what you can do to put those in the vocabulary list. Okay, Tolkien indeed said wonderful things. And here, of course, you go out the door, you can be swept off anywhere, down from the door where it began. And now far away the road has gone, and I must follow, if I can, pursuing it with eager feet,
yeah,
until it joins some larger way. where many paths and errands meet, and whither then I cannot say. And of course, that's what he's talking about here, isn't it? And C.S. Lewis, of course, he, at the very end of his Narnia series, he has them pass into a higher world in which everything is so much more wonderful than it was in the world that they had just quitted. Have you read the last, what is the last one called? I've forgotten.
Oh, no, I haven't read.
It's quite interesting. Fascinating concept there. Okay, and Plato, this is awfully fatalistic. Only the dead have seen the end of war. The fool does think he's wise, but the wise man knows himself to be a fool. Twelfth Night. Now, that's another question, whether Twelfth Night's something we might want to think about. Thomas Edison, I love this one. It's delightful, but he has said better things, I think. I have not failed. I've just found 10,000 ways that won't work. Terrific, terrific. And then logic will get you from A to Z. Imagination will get you anywhere. He said that a number of times in a number of different ways. He talked about imagination is more important than knowledge, quote, quote. And indeed, it was his ability to see these things in his mind that made him ask the real questions. If indeed light goes at the same speed, regardless of the position and velocity of the observer, then somehow you had to bend something else rather than the speed of light. And so he ended up proving that space and time were variable, but the speed of light was not, which sounds very strange. For you, time might be going at a different speed than it is for me in order to resolve these apparent contradictions. And so fascinating ideas. And he came up with these things in his head, and that's what eventually solved.
I was actually today on the internet, and I found some interesting article, something about space travel. And they're trying to devise a way to travel at the speed of light. They said, but there's problems doing that. For example, they said, it's going that fast will change time. And then they were saying how Einstein's theory right there can prove that. He said, if you're traveling that fast, time will go a lot quicker for you than it will in the regular world. So if you're on a rocket, 10 minutes is 20 minutes. And then
time will change. But also, more significantly, when it comes to acceleration, is as one approaches the speed of light,
it gets smaller. Yeah.
The mass increases towards infinity.
Mm-hmm.
And so obviously it's impossible to accelerate anything if its mass approaches infinity as its speed approaches the speed of light, proving that one simply can't reach that speed.
Mm-hmm. That's what they're saying. So for many who think you can travel at the speed of light, it's just impossible, is what they said.
Well, again, just as Einstein's insights superseded and gave us another layer of understanding on top of the celestial mechanics that we understood from Newton. Maybe we'll see another layer on top of that at some point what we understand now is but a subset of what we will eventually understand in the future. We don't know what it is yet. Einstein was looking for it, but he never quite found that reconciliation. Okay, and to J.K. Rowling, it's impossible to live without failing at something unless you live so cautiously that you might as well not have lived at all, in which case you fail by default. Interesting one. Anyone who's never made a mistake has never tried anything new. Okay, good. The couple of those characters there, I couldn't help wanting to give you another couple of quotes because I like this one by Robert Frost so much. And this one I already had in my classroom. You've read this one before, haven't you?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, in the introduction into the classroom, he was asked, what are the rules of the house? Hell, there ain't no rules here. We're trying to accomplish something. Of course, he breaks my major rule, that being language has to conform to academic standards. However, he makes a very good point here. And that being that rules are often antithetical to accomplishing things. And indeed, one can get so tied up with rules that one almost becomes a Vogon, if you see my point. You'll have to understand that that's what Vogons are. How are Vogons described by Adams?
They're described as people who don't really think for themselves, pretty much, and they never really quite put thought into many things. They just kind of, they just do what they're told.
That's an interesting point. That certainly appears to be the case with the Vogon who sent to take them to the airlock.
Yeah.
But the description is they're not actually evil and bureaucratic. And so that this bureaucracy, what is bureaucracy except a stratification of hierarchic entities following rules relative to each other? So it's this excessive following of rules, which, of course, he draws a parallel between the council that comes to knock down his house in order to build a bypass. Is indeed a parallel to the Vogons who come to destroy the planet in order to build a hyperspace bypass. Okay.
I thought those hilarious ones were like.
Exactly. So I love that concept though, because in so many environments, if everybody is on the same page, there are, is really no need for rules. Rules end up having to develop when you've got people who are simply not cooperating correctly. I feel this works particularly well and is particularly important in the classroom, because unfortunately teachers are often tasked with both preparing students for tests and also evaluating their progress. And unfortunately, there's a conflict of interest there. It makes more sense, I think, for everyone to be on the same page. Why is the teacher here? And that's it. And why are the students there? In order to learn. When I was in university, it was commonly understood and accepted that we are not here to learn. We're here to get a degree. And they're not here to teach us. They're here to make it difficult. They're here to make us jump through hoops. And of course, I don't think that education has to be that way. When you meet a teacher who is really willing to jump in and help you accomplish something, then you found something worthwhile. And then you might as well throw the rules out the window, because everybody's trying to do the same thing. There's no reason why one need to impose constraints upon anyone. Robert Frost. Different question altogether here. This quote by Robert Frost, I think, is much more poignant, much more significant than his other one, Life Goes On. This was about free verse. He says, writing free verse is like playing tennis with the net down. Not much of a game, really. You think about that for a moment. There's an awful lot of free verse been written, and it's independent, really, of its structure. There is no structure, but one can put words together in sublimely exalted ways without structure. There's no question about that. The problem is, how many people can do that, and how many poems actually demonstrate something that transcends the structure of the poem itself? And is it necessary to relinquish the structure in order to achieve that level of perfection? And isn't it the ideal if one can achieve it and still have a brilliant structure behind it? I think that Adams demonstrated that admirably in the poem he put together. But let's just take a quick look at this little poem. Net down tennis, anyone? We heard the scores from up above. 15, 30, 40 love. Not sure what I was thinking of when we had just begun. Serves with nothing in between. Return of serve is never seen. Every point has simply been a rally length of one. Already bored, and I'm a set down. This harebrained concept, such a letdown. Playing tennis with the net down, not a lot of fun. Now notice this is in quotes. This rigid form in poetry represses creativity. Abandon it and set us free to frame each moving thought. Thus, free-form poets shun the net and try to urge us to forget what poignant resonances yet deep sounds to words have brought. They feel that random lineation laced with pointless punctuation make art worthy of ovation when it's really not. Now notice the structure here. This is an unusual structure. We heard the scores from up above. This is in tetrameter, and it's iambic tetrameter. But we've got three rhymes together. Above, love, of, when we had just begun, and then it ends with three. So we've got three lines of four, and then one of three. Notice in the Adams poem, we had a line of four, then a line of three, line of four, then a line of three. It's also fairly common to have a line of four, and then a line of four, and then a line of three. And this is sort of the emphasis on the last one. But this one has each third one extended out to a heptametric line. Okay, serves with nothing in between, between seen, been, rally length of one. And notice how we've got the rhyme here, begun, one, fun. The end of every stanza, of the three stanzas, line up together. So we've got three rhymes, and then three stanzas, all of which rhyme with each other. And the same is continued down here. Poetry, creativity, free. Rigid form in poetry represses creativity, abandon us it and set us free to frame each moving thought. And then we have the thought established there. So then we have net, forget, yet, brought. Ation, lineation, punctuation, ovation, not. And so we've got the thought brought, not. And you see the structure.
Yes,
it's a very strict structure. But the point is, of course, the demonstration that it's possible to use a very strict structure and still say exactly what you want to say. You see what I mean? Much unstructured poetry tends to use lineation. In other words, the only thing that distinguishes it from ordinary prose is the fact that they've made the lines shorter, and they don't necessarily make them any specific length, but they make them shorter and often throw in punctuation of different sorts for emphasis or I think perhaps sometimes for confusion, but random lineation, pointless punctuation make art worthy of ovation when it's really not. Anyway, I thought I had to share that one with you based on the fact that somebody put up a Robert Frost quote, and I thought this quote was even better. Okay, sorry about that. Let's go on. Jack, let me just check to see if Jack's here. Nope, don't see him there. Okay, Jack is working on doing some composition, and I'm hoping we can find something he can enjoy working with. He's done a nice little presentation here. Initially had done it all as one big paragraph. This does not work. It's not that there's anything really wrong with one big paragraph, except for the fact that the pedants in the world are not going to appreciate it. So to please the pedants, Let's break it up into paragraphs. 5 is the officially correct number for a basic essay. You folks are all familiar with the 5-paragraph essay, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah.
So there's nothing I need to say about that, except that if you look at the essays of the masters, note that Tolkien wrote some wonderful essays. And you'll find essays written by some really remarkable people. I have quite a lot of those in the classroom. Note what they do when it comes to structure, and you'll realize that this concept of the 5-paragraph essay is really not as sacred as people would like you to think it is. But if you're going to be judged by someone pedantic, then by all means, let's conform to what it is they're expecting. 5-paragraph essay, introductory material defining where you're going with a topic sentence in that first paragraph, and then a summation down below that recaps it all, and then in the middle, the body and the, go ahead.
The three supporting top, three supporting paragraphs.
Right. Yeah, it makes sense to look at it that way. But very much like some of the other devices, some of the other strategies for putting text together, sentence starters, dress-ups, that sort of thing, they're called various different things. Do we put in a dependent clause before we hit the main clause, and there are certain words that we want to avoid? Understandably, I can agree with that, but way is going to produce a somewhat mechanical result, and it's also going to produce a result that can be recognized as the output, as the product of a method, if you see what I mean.
Yeah.
When you start recognizing those specific words popping up in someone's paper, you realize, okay, they're using a method, they're putting things together that way. Not that that's necessarily a bad way to do it. It's certainly a quick, cheap, and easy way to get to conform to something that looks and sounds a little more sophisticated than what one normally encounters. But if we read the works of the masters, let's read John Stuart Mill, let's read Bertrand Russell and Tolkien, for that matter, Woodhouse, and you will find they do not follow those rules. They transcend them. Let's get that into our intuitive language skills, and then let it flow. Let something come that ends up actually being so much better than something that's done by formula, if that makes any sense.
Yes.
And to that end, of course, we want to find as much as possible that's on a level deserving of that kind of emulation, and immerse ourselves in it. So to please the pedants, we'll make it 5 paragraphs. The synesis error, this, I feel that I talk about this just too much, but the problem is people keep using it all the time. And strictly speaking, it is wrong because it's not logical. When we say, and here's the synesis error, everyone has a purpose or calling in life. It's something that they excel at. Okay, well, everyone is singular. They is plural. Is they referring to everyone? Okay, the problem here is this is an error according to the SAT. This is not an error if you look at the works of many great writers, because they do it consistently. Why do they do it? And the problem is very simple. Everyone doesn't tell us whether this is male or female. We don't know the gender of the subject. And now we need to use a pronoun to refer back to that subject. And there is no singular pronoun that doesn't have to assume a gender. It's he or she. We don't have a singular pronoun that's gender-free, so to speak. And so in order to put this sentence together, people tend to go into plural there, because when in plural, you don't have to define the gender. So everyone, they, is fairly common. And the only place I know it to be against the rules, really, is on the SAT. Understandably, there would be people who look at that and say, it's illogical. This is a contradiction. And look up the word synesis. Most people, including grammarians, have no idea what the word synesis means. And it is specifically that kind of an error. Avoid it if you can. I haven't seen it in your papers yet, so I'm probably wasting time talking about it. Otherwise, he put something very nice together here. A few little tiny things. Imagine if I was able to do that to people. Okay, there's nothing wrong with that. It's just that if you feel that it is possible, you use the word was. If you feel that it isn't possible and you're talking in conjecture, then you use the word were. Do you understand the difference there? That use of subjunctive is to let your readership know that the writer is aware that this is a situation contrary to fact. Couldn't possibly be the case. Okay, let's go on. Let's see if we can get the system to respond here. And here we have Kyle's second chapter of your magnum opus. It's nicely put together. This really reads, it's a compelling read. It's nicely done. And I mean, if you look at adventure stories, you've been reading Alexandre Dumas, for example, perfect example, and so many others, Tolkien, you find Tolkien's a little different. Most of them tend to keep the action moving. Tolkien delightfully had these interludes in between the action in which one learns a great deal and gains insight into various other things and sees things that are really beautiful in between the others. But keeping the action rolling seems to be an imperative in modern narrative, and this does it very nicely. The few points I made here were, you still had this problem before. The narration is always in past tense, and you should always try to put in past tense. There are exceptions to that. There are some authors who do, in fact, write in present tense. Damon Runyon is one who's famous for having done that. All right, that's a specific style. Garrison Keillor does it from time to time, but generally, when you're writing a narrative, you're going to talk about something that took place previously and put it in past tense. And when it's in past tense, and one is then in past tense referring to something that took place previously, one needs to go into
had.
Past perfect.
Like using the had.
Exactly, had, right. And so we just have to watch that. Repetition, you did wonderful things with vocabulary. ensanguinated, that's fascinating, and I love it. It may send your readers to the dictionary, but I'm not sure that's always a bad thing. But you can't do it twice. If you use a $10 word, never use the same one again. You have to be careful with that. Okay, and in some cases, one wants to just avoid repetition altogether. If you can, English wants that. Not all languages are as obsessed with it as English is, but in English, you can't afford to use the same word multiple times in the same paragraph or even in successive paragraphs. You need to find a synonym. Maybe that accounts for the vast bulk of synonyms that we find in the English language. The witch was discussed at length in the immersion video I gave you to watch. We should discuss that. Okay, rule create, and If you've read the introduction to the book, our textbook there, it talks about conforming to standard collocation. Are you familiar with the word collocation? It's the juxtaposition of words, very often a verb and a preposition together, to be fond of, but to be upset with, that sort of thing. We don't want to be making new ones that don't really do anything. And this one is awkward. To no success. He tried this to no success. You know, you can say it to no avail. That's actually a standard collocation. Or to no effect, fine, but with no success. Now, how can you tell which one of those is best?
Oh, it's the Google search.
Right. Stick it in quotes, Google search it, look at the count. And if there's any question about whether you're actually looking at the right thing or the examples that you find are actually examples of exactly what you're looking for, look at a few of them, make sure that they are. But in general, that's going to be the best answer. There are a couple of other very good tools for this same kind of thing. You can search, for example, success, and it will give collocations that work with it. That one's called stringnet.net. A couple of others.
I was debating when I wrote it. I originally wrote with no success.
Uh-huh.
And I kept swapping between the two. I was saying, which one should I choose? And then uh-huh. In the end, I'm like, I'm going to say to no success.
Right. No, I understand that syndrome very well. And in fact, I don't know that this is a good solution at all. But when I reread my material, and I'm afraid I'm addicted to rereading and going back and fixing things all the time. Some people can manage to go through and then just leave it and let it go. But I have to go back and reread. And when rereading, I think the same thing three times, I make the change. I don't know if that's good or not, but if I look at it and think about that change, maybe, maybe not. If I end up doing it a third time, then it's worth making the change, if that makes any sense. I'm not sure that's a good rule at all, but it's one that I've ended up adopting. This promises to be a very impressive work. I hope to see it completed and published. I'm serious. I don't see any reason why this should not stand up to competition and be submitted to an agent and a publisher. If you can take it to its, you know, finish it up. Nice descriptions here. A faint, fetid odor. Beautiful. Fetid is very nice, but odor is fairly common. How about redolence or miasma? Did you look up the word miasma? This probably goes into your vocabulary list.
It's in this book.
Okay, I'm sure it's in there somewhere. Okay. It filled the atmosphere. How about permeated? Just something a little bit different. Again, if you look at the IEW charts, you'll find a set of words that are just, that they've been used so commonly and so frequently that they don't really have any meaning anymore. And these are put on the list of words not to use. I don't know if filled is in there, probably isn't. But he's got a very good point there. Let's say those words, they're like old chewing gum. They've lost their flavor altogether. There's no point in using them anymore. There are better words that have more specific meaning. So to permeate, just one suggestion. There are many things that one could do there. Here's our case of past perfect. Very nice descriptions. Ever since it began, the sky had been slightly orange. Really was doesn't work there because we are going into the past from the past again. Okay, now this change here, do you see why I made that change? Who tended to violently scarf her meals down He took scant bites, lengthening his meal.
I'm not. Is it because it sounds better? Has a better flow?
Yes, actually, when it comes down to it, that's the answer. But more specifically, it sounds better because this is a split infinitive. We've got the to scarf is our verb, and we stick something in there. Now, a split infinitive is a non-error. It's not really regarded as an error, certainly not a serious one anymore. But my contention is, if you don't know whom you're writing for, assume them to be offended by things that some people might find offensive. So in other words, let's not throw something in there that's going to offend some subset of our readership when it's so easy to do something that will not offend anybody. And indeed, the change I made here, I think, falls into that category. Who tended to scarf her meals down violently. She took scant bites. Scant might be right. Exiguous. You know, not going to work. It's exactly the right thing. Now, I had a little trouble here also. Meal. How about repast? Let's find some other word for it instead of repeating it. Okay. The festered corpse. Festered, of course, implies that the festering process has completed, probably. And yet, I don't think it has, because it's still putrescent. And so I think that I suggested festering, so it's still in the process. And putrescent is very nice. You get that also out of the book?
Yeah.
Okay. I like putrescent a little better than putrid. Putrid has become towards the common end of meaning, whereas putrescent, I think, means a little bit more, and people understand it. Number of flies and maggots who thrived. You know, throve is actually a word as well, but thrived is acceptable inside the massive gash in the deceased man's back. Okay, we're fetid again here. And fetid is a wonderful word, but it's probably too unique a word, too special a word to use more than once.
That's where it was. When I was looking back at it, I noticed fetid. Fetid. And I thought to myself, didn't I put that somewhere earlier? And I kept looking through, I'm like, I can't find it, so I guess I'm good.
Right. No, I find myself doing the same thing. Have I used this before? You could resort to stench, or there are a number of other words that one could use there. Excellent imagery and vocabulary. And that's probably unfair for me to say that, because so much of that vocabulary is material from the textbook, which I think is perfectly reasonable. But my opinion is probably a little bit skewed. Okay, here again, we've got man. I'm sure you could avoid the repetition somehow or other with opponent or adversary or something, something like that. Ensanguinated, wonderful, but never used it twice. Okay, now here's just a matter of meaning here. Standing up proved to be an onerous feat in itself. Onerous generally means distasteful, something one doesn't want to undertake. And indeed, it might apply there, but I thought arduous might be a little closer. Does that make any sense?
Yes.
You know, because onerous is something like take out the garbage, not something like stand up. Stagnant. I'm not sure that's the right word for it. Motionless stagnant is not usually used to mean an immobile corpse. Okay, and here's the with no success or to no avail. Otherwise, it's nice writing. It's very, very solid. and it it progresses well. It keeps one focused, and yet it's not all action. A lot of it is anticipation. One of the things I find somewhat disturbing about action stories is action which doesn't really make mechanical sense. Now, I'm not necessarily saying that that's the case here, but you're describing things very nicely. You describe this altercation, this this battle, but throughout the story, up to that point, there's a constant reference to this Bowie knife he's carrying, or whatever it is, and his hand on the hilt of it, to find then that he hasn't drawn it rapidly enough when he's being attacked with a hatchet, I find a little bit hard to reconcile with the rest of the story as it's been presented. Do you see what I mean? So I don't know. That's the sort of thing that bothers me a little bit.
Yeah. I thought that too when I wrote it. So originally he was pulling it out, then he ducked from the hatchet, and then when he had it out, he got tackled. But then I realized, well, how you could unsheath the knife very fast.
Yeah. So I'm not sure as a plot device it works well, but there are plot devices that don't work well that have worked successfully in literature throughout its history. So I don't know that that's necessarily as important as it might seem. Okay, nicely done. What have we got in the way of time? Close to the end, I'm afraid. Okay, let's go back. Here's our agenda. Here's language immersion that I assigned to you. I hope this video worked out well for you. Were you able to watch it? Because I had it queued up to the middle where he started.
Yeah. I assumed you were the one who said that.
Yeah.
So I was able to watch it from the parts.
Fry is awkward. Fry is difficult. His language is absolutely exquisite, but he tends to wander off into the gutter all the time, which makes it inappropriate for classroom use. And so I cut some of that material out, but it's in almost everything he does. He can't seem to stay away from it. Well, there are some specific presentations he's done which simply don't lend themselves to that, and that's fine. He's done some lectures for graduating classes, for example, where he manages to avoid the profanity, but not for very long. However, his insight into language itself and his study of language itself, he's done a number of presentations on language, and very well done. For example, there's one in which he traverses the British Isles, in the process of which he demonstrates all the different dialects as he goes along. That's not easy to do, and I have no doubt that he's doing it as well as I can tell. He's doing it very well. He has vast understanding of literature and of philology and many other subjects. There is a program which I'm reluctant to recommend simply because of Fry's rather scatological predilections, if you like. Look that up. But it's called Quite Interesting. It's a quiz show, and he's the master of ceremonies in it. And the program involves questions to which nobody really knows the answer, but he's got a number of very sharp contestants there who are very good at coming up with interesting answers, and that's why the program is called what it is, Quite Interesting. And it's immensely funny and very, very entertaining, but as I said, not particularly safe. And so I'm not going to recommend it because I don't want you to look at it. And then your parents look at it and says, who told you to watch that? Okay. But in that one, he, as the question setter, he's almost omniscient. He's actually wearing a little thing in his ear with people in the background looking things up for him very rapidly and giving it to him. So he's cheating in a way, but he already has such an encyclopedic understanding of so many different fields. Two things I would recommend from him. One of them is a book called The Ode Less Traveled. The Ode Less Traveled. It's of course a takeoff. It's using an existing quote
from Robert Frost. The road less traveled by, and that's made all the difference.
Exactly. It is a reference to that one, but this is The Ode Less Traveled. He's talking about poetry, and he mentions it in this. We have it in the classroom. About. It's not the whole thing in the classroom. It's some Russian has put it up online, but I've got a link to it there. And you can go and read the whole thing. I bought it. I have the hard copy, which I have gone through thoroughly. It's a delightful book on the writing of poetry. Now, I have to ask here, perhaps a little bit late today, having launched into verse a good deal earlier on, the extent to which you folks have any interest at all in poetry.
I like poetry, but it's kind of hard for me to come up with it. But I enjoy it. It's not that I hate poetry. It's just kind of hard for me to come up with anything.
It's hard for everybody.
Yeah.
It's particularly hard if you have any discrimination whatever. There are a lot of people who can't discriminate between good stuff and bad stuff, and they come up with poetry by the bucketful. I hate to say that, but there's no question about it. If you're interested, we can look at it further in poetic devices. And so by all means, write something poetic and hand it in if you feel like it. I think that understanding the structure of poetry is important. You don't have to know all of the terminology necessarily, but understanding the feel for it, it's much like music. If it sounds right, it's right. It doesn't matter if you've broken some rule somewhere along the line.
I've been playing guitar for a long time, and I don't know how to read music, but I can still play guitar. So you don't necessarily have to know all the structures of how to make music if you can just come up with it.
Exactly.
Kind of the same way for poetry.
Exactly. It's but playing something that has been circumscribed and defined, that is something that used to be the standard of learning music in the past, because the existence of music depended upon writing it down in some form so that people could play it. That's not true anymore. You can just get a computer to play it. You can play it with a recording. You can do that all over the place. What humans are good for is coming up with something new that's never been done before. And that's, of course, what we do in our classes, understanding the principles behind it so that we can compose and work on a system.
That's almost exactly what Stephen Fry was saying on the show, comparing playing guitar to writing the poetry.
Exactly. You know, the point was well made. And also, of course, he goes on to talk about the English language itself and the fact that he is not pedantic about language. He's not concerned. You saw that earlier video that I gave you of his. You didn't see him in it, but he was the one who was talking about the language itself in that one with all of the, I can't remember what the name of the video was. You know which one I mean, right?
Isn't it the one Born Talking? But I thought that was Jonathan Miller.
Not Born Talking.
Oh.
This was a very short video. Did I was assigned that to you? I think I must have.
With Stephen Fry.
Stephen Fry, yes. That's the British spelling.
This is the first time Stephen Fry. The only other language, anything on language we've seen besides that was the Jonathan Miller.
Okay, I've got to give you that one then. It's a very short discussion of language and what is important to him about language. It's not a matter of getting your who's Watson, which is all straightened out, or your synthesis for that matter, and so forth. It's a matter of enjoying the rich realms of language that our language presents to us, that the English language is replete with immense expressive capability and an incredible vocabulary. He mentions that in there. Do you remember what he says about the vocabulary? English has a vastly larger vocabulary than any other language. It compares to much like the population of China when it comes to the population of words in the language. English is a parallel there, though he said it much more effectively than I did. So we will encounter him again. He's done a number of presentations, which I would like to be able to bring in, and we'll see what I can do to find ones that are appropriate. Okay, this was one of the big things I wanted to get to, and we're already running over, I'm sorry. Let's look at it, and there's always so much more to do later on. But many of these are atoms. Certainly this collection that I put together here was inspired initially by Adams, but indeed he's not the only one to have done these things, and I have no doubt that he was influenced by some of the others, including Woodhouse and almost certainly Lewis Carroll. What is Lewis Carroll famous for? Alice in Wonderland. And indeed, this is from Alice Through the Looking
Glass. It does, and I think if you think about it, it does tend to have the same feel, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, and some of the way that the sentences are made.
Mm-hmm. There's certainly some influence going on there. And I think Woodhouse, more so probably when it comes to expressive comedic devices, whereas with Lewis Carroll, he worked very heavily with logical devices. And this is something that Adams also does. He plays around with logic a certain amount. And so logic and mathematics was Lewis Carroll's background. In fact, he wrote a book on logic. And it's actually fascinating, and it's a delightful read. Okay, so let's look at this. The absence of presence, I couldn't think of a better way to describe it, but when we talk about ships hanging in the sky much the same way that bricks don't, that's we're using the absence of something or as though it was actually present. And this one finds in so many different places. A. Milne, of course, Winnie the Pooh. The more he looked for Piglet, the more Piglet wasn't there. Nothing happened, and for quite a while, nothing continued to happen. Again, using the absence of something as though it were actually something there. And I like this one of Lewis Carroll. The White King asks, "Do you see anybody coming down the road?" And Alice says, "I see nobody." To which he responds, "Oh, that I had such eyes, that I could see nobody, and at such a distance." Same idea, isn't it? I'm sitting here completely surrounded by no beer. That's from, if you've ever seen it, Keeping Up Appearances, Onslow. And in his normal state, he would not strike a lamb. I've known him to do it. Do what? Not strike lambs. Again, absence of something. And the famous new dramatic machine, entirely unlike tea. Okay. These devices are important to understand, I think. It's perhaps It's perhaps unfair to be taking his language apart this way and saying this is why it's funny, but it does fall into a number of categories, and you can easily use these. For example, when Arthur Dent asks, and you have both read this part, Arthur Dent asks, "Where are we?" And Ford says, "We're safe."
You're safe.
Okay. Where are we? We're on a Vogon ship in the Vogon constructor fleet, to which he responds, "Well, this is obviously some strange usage of the word safe that I wasn't previously aware of." Do you see how that's just so delightfully self-referential is really what it is. And later on, I can't remember where this one happens. He was surprised at this. But then when it came to that, surprise was no longer adequate, and he was forced to resort to astonishment. You see the word, the effect of that. All right. So anyway, go ahead and look at these if you like. There's this part here is very, very simple. It's just the use of a traditional idiom. You can't use one of these more than once. And Adams uses them sparingly. When you use it more than once, it really doesn't work out well. I could see that if not actually disgruntled, he was far from being gruntled. You understand what's going on there? Okay. Not a single fribble. Okay. Any questions? Okay. I'm afraid I'm going to have to ask you to read a little more next time.
So oh, yeah.
We have something more to look at.
I didn't have a lot of time last week.
I'm tempted, though, not to suggest that you read as so much as watch and listen. I will try to find some other sources of the audio books, first of all. By the way, Adams made his own audio books.
Audio book
versions. And then later, Fry came along and did them. Fry has also done all of the Harry Potter series as well. I mean, beautifully done, superbly done. Okay. So is there something else that we need to add in? Are we addressing all of your problems? You're doing well. I want to see the next chapter. I realize those chapters are substantial and take some time. I'm gonna see more of your work.
Yeah. It's funny, though, but I'm working on a little story. It might probably be done this week, though. So.
Stories are fine. Essays are fine. But probably the most important thing is get it flowing. See if you can sit down and write something every day. Learn to sit down and get it to come. And I'd like to recommend here, listen to the immersion assignments before you sit down and start working. And you might even try doing some recitation of really fine writing. And then sit down and start writing yourself and seeing whether you can't sort of expand upon that which you are already absorbing. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Any questions?
No.
Okay, well, let's call that it for now. I will think of something. I know that you don't have enough homework left, so I'll see if I can add some more. There is the rest of Born Talking, of course. Have you finished that?
No, I'm almost done.
Okay, that's an ongoing thing. Go ahead and listen to more of it if you like. Okay, and just in case you run out of things, I've always got the lower priority assignments down here.
Okay.
You can go on to, but I'll find something more for you. Okay, let's call that it for today, and I will post more later. Until next week.